pockets from the Magnes collection with ideas from speakers. Every one speaker every week, and we follow the semesters, and so we are now in the middle of the spring semester, and it's a real pleasure to welcome Ron Feldman to this series. We've been talking about doing something together for quite some time. You can read Ron's biography and his titles. He's a visiting scholar at GPU. He's definitely an important voice in the Jewish community in Berkeley. But as a former young European scholar of Jewish studies, I have this very soft spot for Ron because years ago, at this point I can say many years ago, that's fine. We both have enough gray hair to say that. He edited an important collection of Anna's writings about Jews that was eventually translated to Italian at the very beginning of my university life, and that really helped changing the way I personally thought about Jewish studies. So it has it was wonderful to meet him in person when I came to the Bay Area, and I'm really delighted to have him talk about the core of his research, his later research, not on Anna's, but on notions of Jewish time. I want to point your attention to the item we're displaying today. It's a painted manuscript. Germany, we speculate southern Germany, 18th century. It's a calendar for counting the Omer. So we're getting close to that time. And it's a piece of Kabbalistic work because it combines each day of the Omer as Don Common with connections between the city of Orianic Kabbalah, and also includes texts like Anabokoa and Psalm 67 that are part of the whole Kabbalistic textual enterprise. It's beautifully decorated, and everybody's welcome at the end of the talk to come and take a closer look. You will afterwards, as it's customary for the talk to present here, will then go back into storage. So you may not see it. It was on display a couple years ago. You may not see it again for some time, so use up your chance. And please join me in welcoming Ron to the stage.
Thank you, Francesco, for that generous introduction. And thank you all for coming. I know this is for some people, it's an odd time to come. I guess for all of you, it worked out. So that's good. So thank you. And it's about time that we did this. So I appreciate that. So this is about keeping Jewish time. And Jewish time is central to what
to Judaism. Rabbi Samson Raphael Hirsch, who was the founder of modern Orthodoxy, wrote in the 19th century that the catechism of the Jew consists of his calendar. He used those gender terms, so I thought I'd report that. And then Abraham Joshua Heschel wrote that Judaism is a religion of time aiming at the sanctification of time. And probably time is in some ways more important than place in Judaism as a diasporic culture and religion in many ways. Now, I kind of came to the study of this, as Francesco alluded to, I've had other academic interests, but I came to this because I was interested in exploring Judaism's attitude towards nature and the environment. And given the importance of calendars and time to Judaism, I decided to look to calendars as a lens to understand Jewish attitudes to nature. So what I'm going to talk about here is kind of two parallel and intertwined inquiries. One is, what is the history and practice of Jewish timekeeping? And what do these practices say about Jewish attitudes towards the natural world? And in the end, as the description of this talk said, I'm going to focus on the contrast between the lunar month, which is a natural cycle of time, versus the Sabbath, which is a non-natural cycle of time. We can characterize it in other ways, as an artificial cycle, as a cultural cycle, as a divine cycle. There's many other ways to talk about it. But in terms of environmental thought, that would be the beginning. So to just give you a sense of how this talk is going to go, I have a number of topics. I'm going to talk about concordant calendars, the purpose of calendars in general. Then I'll move on to biblical sources for Jewish time. Then we'll talk about rabbinic texts and rabbinic calendars. Then the Dead Sea Scrolls calendars. And then the historic sequence, my hypothesis about the historic sequence of developing of Jewish time through the calendars, how Jewish time developed over time, that kind of thing. So, there's so many puns available with this topic, I'll try to keep them to a minimum. The one-year kind of time, concordant time, is very important in most cultures today. So this is an example of where we are today. This is a concordant calendar that shows within the month of March, the Jewish months, the Jewish calendar. So today we're on March 22nd, which happens to be the 24th of Adar. And it's interesting to think in this context, which calendar is primary or secondary? And I think it's clear that the Gregorian calendar is the primary calendar. Because we don't have the framework of, it's not showing the month of Adar and then March and April within Adar. It's showing March and then Adar within March, that sort of thing. One of my favorite things is, when I first started studying at GTU, I remember one year, this was a while ago, Professor Seidman asked me, when is Tu B'Shvat this year? And I said, it's on Tu B'Shvat, because that means it's on the 15th of Shvat. He said, yes, but when is it? So that has to do with what's foreground and background in terms of how we feel time and experience time, which shows us the cultural context of time. Now, concordant calendars are important. This is an example. I have a few examples from the Magnes collection here. This is from 1902. It's a greeting card for the calendar for the year, published in Jerusalem. And I have a little close-up here. You can see it's basically columns for each month showing the date of the Gregorian month along with the Hebrew dates and when the Hebrew holidays formed. So this is kind of a list form as opposed to a matrix form that we saw as the one we usually use today, but this is a typical form. And then we have another one that uses lists too from the Magnes collection from Calcutta, which is interesting, which also has columns for the year, but apparently it shows not only the Christian calendar, but the Muslim and Hindu calendars concordantly too. And the little bit of research I've done, I've found, you know, they have very nice date books going back to the 1700s of Jewish calendars that are concordant, you know, that merchants in Europe would use. So the concordant calendar is important. And in the Ottoman Empire, there were concordant calendars too for the Jewish and Islamic calendar. And nowadays, you can just go online and you can get concordant calendars of all sorts. Here's the Islamic, Christian, Hindu, Jewish, Sikh, Buddhist. Just choose what you want. It's very convenient to do concordant calendars today. I just have my Hebrew calendar apps on my iPhone. It's just easy to do nowadays. But I want to talk about calendars in general and just kind of an overall look at it. And I think of calendars as a way of negotiating the human and natural realms through time. This is kind of my environmentalist perspective. I like to say that every culture has its calendar, its map of time. I want to modify that by saying almost. I can't say for every culture, but most that we deal with, and certainly the Jewish culture. Calendars represent humanity's effort to understand and predict the chronological dimension of natural events that affect their lives. Now, different calendars are maps of time that represent different relationships between humans, God, and nature. That's going to be my focus on the Jewish calendar as well. So, every calendar is a unique cultural construction that is a narrative of time that mediates the lived experience of time itself. It becomes part of a culture's assumptions. It was like that discussion I had with Nomi, so when is it? Like, what's the underlying cultural assumption? We live within a framework that today is March 22nd. It's, you know, that's the cultural construction. Like language, a calendar becomes not only a way of describing reality, but also defines the parameters within which that reality is both lived and is limited. So we have certain cultural constructs, like when do certain cycles begin, and how are they grouped and counted? The day, the month, the year, the week. You know, when do they begin and end? Those are all cultural constructs for things that are almost unending cycles. So calendars have tended to start with the observed phenomena of days, lunations, that is the lunar month, but even saying lunar month assumes a certain way of thinking about it. So I like the term lunation. And the solar stellar years, relating to these the periods of light and dark, warm and cold, dry and wet, activity and rest, growth and dormancy, life and death. And of course, the movements of the heavenly bodies, the sun, the moon, and the stars, define the rhythms to which humans and the rest of the earth are subject, yet over which humans really have no physical control. Excuse me, I've had the flu all week, so apologize for that. One further thing I want to say about this is that in terms of the solar stellar years, we tend to think of the seasons as controlled by the sun due to us being Copernicans, basically. But if you, ancients mostly saw that the changing stars are what indicated the different seasons. So that's why I call it the solar stellar year. It was really changing constellations that indicated the changing seasons. So a calendar expresses, there are different ways of approaching calendars traditionally in academia. One is the sociological. So this quote is from Emil Durkheim. A calendar expresses the rhythm of the cultural collective activities, while at the same time its function is to assure their regularity. So he sees calendars as social constructs that unify a society. From Mircea Eliade, the scholar of religion, he talks about religious man experiences two kinds of time, profane and sacred. The one is an evanescent duration, the other a succession of eternities, periodically recoverable during the festivals that make up the sacred calendar. The religious experiences of the festival, that is, participation in the sacred, enables man periodically to live in the presence of the gods. It is by virtue of this eternal return to the sources of the sacred and the real that human existence appears to be saved from nothingness and death. And therefore, it's very critical to observe sacred times at the right time. So a lot of the calendar issues and calendrical conflicts in Jewish history have to do with thinking about constructing what is the right time to have a particular observance. And furthermore, I want to add the political piece, which is controlling and determining calendars is politically powerful. Today, the Gregorian calendar is the worldwide standard, but that's the result of European colonialism and capitalism. We have an international dateline, and we have time zones, which kind of more moves into the issue of clocks than calendar. But all this is a result, you know, it's a political organization. It's a political construct, really. But it's now, we have a worldwide system that's consistent and accepted. So I want to, just for context, explain different, give you a context of a little bit of different calendars before we move into the Jewish calendar. The Gregorian calendar is a calculated calendar. It tries to conform to the solar year. There's 12 months which are schematic, that is, the months don't relate to the moon. The days start at midnight, on clock time, of course. And the weeks, the seven-day week, is a pattern inherited from Judaism. The Islamic calendar, in contrast, is based on the observation of the first crescent. It's still observational, at least in theory. And it's 12 lunar months, so it's about 11 days short of a solar year every year, and everyone knows that the Islamic calendar, the holidays shift through the seasons because it's 11 days short every year. Because 12 lunar cycles equals about 354 days. The days start at sunset, which is typical for the lunar calendar traditions. And the weeks are also a pattern inherited from Judaism. Excuse me. Then we get to the Jewish calendar. The current one that's used is also based on calculation. It's 12 or 13 lunar months, and the primary time block is the lunar month, the lunation, adjusted, but it's adjusted for the solar stellar year. So about 7 years, not about, but in 7 years out of 19-year cycle, there are leap years where a lunar month is added, Adar 2, so to speak. Another time we can get into that process. The days start at sunset, and the weeks, of course, are from the Bible. Now, these, I want to just talk about different attitudes towards time that are included here. So, if you have a calendar based on observation, it's what I call, from an environmental perspective, wild time versus calculation, which is tame time. So, on an observational system, you're dependent on observation that results and creates an attitude of uncertainty and subservience. that as humans must conform to the sacred times determined by the God, by God or gods as indicated in the heavens, and religious observance must be at the correct time. In other words, it's kind of an attitude where humans are adapting to the natural cycles because the natural cycles are somehow divinely created or are divinities themselves. On a calculated system, we mark time at standard intervals, and it can operate independently of natural events. Humans are empowered or of necessity or are necessary to determine or declare sacred time. So, for example, the Sabbath is a calculated sense of time, and it's only by humans observing the Sabbath that the Sabbath exists. It's not a natural cycle of time. So I want to talk about how in the ancient world, and perhaps some contemporaneously, the kind of contrast between monotheists and astral polytheists. And of course, in the Bible, there's a lot of discussion about astral polytheism too, worshiping the heavenly lights. Many cultures worship the heavenly lights as divine beings, and there is an environmental truth of this deification, and that is that they have a decisive role in the conduct of terrestrial life, whether it's sun, usually equals the day, the moon, of course, rules the night, the stars rule the seasons, and the theological argument between monotheists and polytheists was not about the power of the heavenly lights, but whether they were independent gods or witnesses to the even greater power of a single God who created them. I think most of you probably know the Jewish attitude towards that, but I wanted to quote here from a couple of key texts that we have. So this is the Bible, Genesis, on the origin of time. And God said, "Let there be lights in the expanse of the sky to separate the day from night. They shall be for signs and for set times, moedim, which become the holidays, and for days and for years. And they shall serve as lights in the expanse of the sky to shine upon the earth." And it was so. And God made the two great lights, the greater light to dominate the day and the lesser light to dominate the night and the stars. And God set them in the expanse of the sky to shine upon the earth, to dominate the day and night, and to separate light from darkness. And God saw that this was good, and there was an evening and morning, a fourth day. But that's not the only Jewish time in the Bible. Of course, that fourth day is within the 7 days of creation. And in Genesis, it concludes, "And the heaven and earth were finished in all their array. On the seventh day, God finished the work that he had been doing. He ceased on the seventh day from all the work that he had done." So, of course, that's the seven-day week. But it's only when we get to the Ten Commandments, two versions in Exodus and Deuteronomy, that say, "Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy," or alternatively, "Observe the Sabbath day and keep it holy." Now, of course, the Sabbath is not natural, and you have to, I like combining these two commandments to say you have to remember to observe it. Otherwise, it doesn't really happen. Unlike the stars, you can always, if you forget about the stars or the moon, you can always, like, if you're knocked out for a week or two and then wake up, you can kind of refigure where you are. You can't really do that with the Sabbath because it's not a natural cycle. And there's more to say about that, but there's more to say about all of this. So we'll leave it for the questions. Now, what is the attitude, Jewish attitude about time? I like going back to Heschel. Thank you. Heschel writes that Jewish ritual may be characterized as the art of significant forms in time, as architecture of time. Most of its observance, the Sabbath, the new moon, the festivals, the sabbatical, the jubilee year, depend on a certain hour of the day or season of the year. But there is a tension between the cycles of Sabbath and the moon, which the moon, of course, controls the holidays in the Jewish calendar. So here's what he says about that. While the festivals celebrate events that happen in time, the date of the month assigned for each festival in the calendar is determined by the life in nature. The date of all festivals is a day in the month, and the month is a reflection of what goes on periodically in the realm of nature. Since the Jewish month begins with the new moon and with the reappearance of the lunar crescent in the evening sky. So on one hand, that's kind of a natural, wild rhythm of time. On the other hand, in contrast, the Sabbath is entirely independent of the month and unrelated to the moon. Its date is not determined by any event in nature, such as the new moon, but by the act of creation. Thus, the essence of the Sabbath is completely detached from the world of space. It's artificial in that sense, it's cultural, and it's tame. We know the Sabbath because we count the time, and it's up to humans to count the time. So, the Bible has both kinds of time, and in some sense they're both divinely created, but as I like to put it, the Bible is an enabler of calendrical diversity and conflict, as we shall see. How so? So these passages, there's actually no clarity about the months, which are not even mentioned. What is a month? How many days in a month? When does the month begin? And years, how many days or months or Sabbaths and weeks in a year? When does a year begin? Dates of certain holidays, how the Sabbath and the holidays coordinate. These are all unmentioned things, and different Jewish calendars have constructed these relationships differently. So I'm going to go over, in the rest of this presentation, I'm going to go over four different calendars in the Jewish tradition and how these answer these questions differently and solve this lack of fit between the Sabbath and the moons differently. These are mainly from the Second Temple period. And just as a way of background to that, what about even earlier? I think that the calendar of the First Temple period, which ended in 587 BCE with the destruction of Jerusalem by the Babylonians, it was probably a version of the Mesopotamian lunisolar calendar that was observational. And there's big questions about whether the Sabbath in that period was a full moon observance or a seventh day observance. I'm not going to go into that in this particular presentation, but I think that's the background, that's the remote background for the discussion we'll be having about these calendars. And so I'm going to talk about first the calculated lunar solar calendar, which is one we have that evolved between the 2nd to 9th century CE. Previous to that was the observational lunar solar calendar that was evolved sometime between the 2nd century BCE and the 2nd century CE, maybe, and evolved a little later into the calculated calendar. And then there was a 364-day priestly calendar that was sometime in the early to mid 2nd Temple period, 5th century to 1st century. And then there's a 364-day Jubilees calendar. Jubilees dates from the 2nd century BC and is probably was being used in some fashion through the 1st century CE. Of course, the temple in Jerusalem was destroyed in 70 CE in the 1st century. So things really changed after that. So to go over the current Jewish calendar, is fully calculated, and it's been pretty much unchanged since the 9th century. That, in Jewish time, that's not so old, right? So it, of course, has 12 or 13 calculated lunar months in a year. The months are either 29 or 30 days long because the lunar cycle is about 29 and a half. And I say about, so it varies a little bit from that. I won't go into those details. They have Babylonian month names, which is always peculiar in the Jewish calendar. You know, quote Babylonian, that is, you know, some of the names are names of ancient gods and goddesses from the ancient Near East. A version of the, and so they're a version of the ancient Mesopotamian calendars. And there's an uneasy symbiosis between the three cycles of time, the solar year, the lunar months, and the Sabbath. And the Sabbath, the week, runs independently of the months and the years. And you can see that this is a challenging synchrony that happens in terms of the annual weekly Torah readings. You know, they have to expand and contract depending on the year, and they kind of run into each other. It's just, it's been worked out, but that's why we need those concordant calendars, because it's complicated, and then we need those as just a guide of, like, what's the parsha this week? So, it's not convenient. You'll see we'll get some calendars that were much more convenient. Too bad they didn't work very well. So, let's move on to the earlier version of this, it's known from the Mishnah that in the Talmudic period, the calendar was observational. So I'd say sometime between 100 and 400 CE. The Mishnah was composed around 200 CE. And what was being observed? Well, the first crescent of the new moon was the key. And the question was always whether it was going to appear on day 30 or day 31 following the prior sighting. Because the lunar cycle is 29 and a half days long, and visibility is a challenge, it wasn't always, you know, due to environmental factors, you know, weather, haze, etc., in addition to just astronomy. But why did it become calculated if it was observational? Well, it's probably politics between the Jewish communities in the land of Israel versus the diaspora, especially the Babylonian communities in the East, wanted certainty in observation holidays. And this is where we have the origin of some holidays being observed for 2 days in the diaspora. And that is because you weren't sure if, let's say, Rosh Hashanah or Sukkot or whatever was going to fall on the 30th day after the last new moon or the 31st day, making a 29 or 30 day month. And so that uncertainty meant that they would, in order to get it right, they would observe the holiday for 2 days. They didn't observe Yom Kippur for 2 days because they didn't want to fast for 2 days. So, pardon? What? Yes. So, in the land of Israel, you know, they continue to want to assert their historic right to observe and declare the new moon and therefore set the calendar holiday. So there was an ongoing evolution of between the diaspora and the community in the land of Israel about who was setting the calendar. So it took until about the 9th century to have the final issues resolved, and it hasn't really changed since. Now, I want to move now to the observational calendar, which these texts are from the Mishnah, an early part of the Talmud. Now, the historical settings are both before and after the destruction of the Jerusalem temple by the Romans in 70 CE. And who were these people who were doing these calendars? Perhaps the Pharisees, who were generally considered the predecessors to the rabbis who composed the Mishnah. It's hard to say if these accounts are historically accurate, but they were certainly used to explain and justify later practices. So they describe an observational lunisolar calendar that is focused on the correct marking of the first crescent of the new moon, which is considered the beginning of the lunar month. I have a little show and tell here about the Mishnah. So I want to give you a few quotes from the Mishnah. There are many, many more, but I want to highlight a few things. Now, there was a large courtyard in Jerusalem which was called Beit Yazek, and all the witnesses would gather there, and the court would examine them there, and they would make meals for them so that they should make it their habit to come. And I love this quote because this is the origin of providing food at Jewish ceremonies and gatherings. So it goes back to the Mishnah, at least, as an incentive for people to come. So we have a few snacks in the back here. It seems to be a requirement, so or at least a custom, let's put it that way. So thank you for the snacks, Francesco. And it seems like they may have had, if they had to provide snacks, maybe they had challenge in getting witnesses to show up. Just want to put that piece of doubt in your mind. Now here's another interesting piece. So they talk about witnesses. If a father and his son saw the new moon, they go. Rabbi Yossi said, it once happened that Tuvia, the physician, saw the new moon in Jerusalem. And he and his son and his freed servant and the priests accepted him and his son as witnesses. But they disqualified his servant. And when they came before the court, they accepted him and his servant and they disqualified his son. Now what I find interesting, a lot of the legal commentary on this has to do with who's an appropriate witness? Is a servant an appropriate witness? Is the son? Because you always have to have two witnesses to things. So is the son acceptable with his father? That sort of thing. But to me, in terms of calendrical use, what's interesting to me is it seems like the priests have a different calendar going on than the people in the court. In other words, certain witnesses were accepted by them and certain witnesses were accepted by them. It seems like there are two calendar systems, two calendar courts going on. And one is the priests, who, of course, ran the temple, which brings up the question, what calendar was being used in the temple? Well, I'll get back to that later. So, if they do not know him, that is the witness, they send another with him to testify about him, to say that he's a good guy. Originally, they accepted testimony of the new moon from any man, but after the sectarians' evil practices, they enacted that they should only accept from those they knew. So there are sectarians. There are people who did things that were troubling or caused problems for the people operating this method. And furthermore, let's see. Here. If a person saw the new moon and is unable to walk, they bring him on an ass or even on a bed. And if any lion wait for them, they take sticks in their hands. If the way is long, they take food in their hands, because for a journey lasting a night and a day, they may violate the Sabbath, Shabbat, and they go forth to give testimony about the new moon, as it is written, "These are the festivals of the Lord, which you shall proclaim in their appointed season." So here is a very interesting piece where they are, there's two things I want to point out here. One is they're commanded to violate the Sabbath in order to report the new moon. The observance of the new moon is more important than the Sabbath here. And they have to take sticks in their hands because there may be people lying in wait for them. Now, are these simple robbers, or are these people who are trying to resist their violation of the Sabbath? We can see that in Jerusalem today, people resisting others who are violating the Sabbath. So this is perhaps a part of the Jewish tradition. So, at the end of the process, the head of the court says, "It is sanctified," and all the people answer after him, "It is sanctified, it is sanctified," Mikudash. Whether it was seen in its proper time, whether it was not seen in its proper time, they sanctify it. Now, proper time is a technical term, as you read these texts, for day 30, which means the big question is if you're going to see the new moon at the 30th day after the previous one, because if you don't, it will certainly appear on the next day. So the key question is whether it appears at its proper time. That's a technical term at this point. Although, yeah, that's all I'll say at this point. And then what would happen? Well, then they would light flares. But after the Kuthians' evil practice, they enacted that messengers should go forth. So they would light flares, but later they sent out messengers, runners, with the information that the new moon had been declared and the month had been declared. Now, this is kind of reminds me of that scene in The Lord of the Rings. You know, how did they light the fairs? They brought long poles of cedar wood and reeds and wood and chips of flax and tied them together. And he went up to the top of the hill and he set fire to them and he waved to and fro, raised and lowered until he saw his fellow doing likewise on the top of the second hill and so too on the top of the third hill. And it goes hill to hill to hill all the way to the towns in Babylon in the east through Syria and Babylon. So, that was the original theory. Now, a number of questions come up here. You know, when is, why did they meet at this place called Beit Yazek, if not the temple? I mean, if they were in charge of the temple, like who was running the temple? Well, the priests were running the temple. Maybe this group, the Pharisees, perhaps, were operating their own system that maybe or maybe not was related to the temple. And who were their opponents? Well, I think that now we can say safely that they were followers of the calendar tradition found in the Dead Sea Scrolls. And at various times, perhaps this included the temple priests, perhaps they were Sadducees, Sadducim, the Bothusians, Bitocin, the Essenes, or what I call the Qumranites, the people from Qumran, maybe even Hasmoneans, who were the Maccabeans. There are various groups that at various times could have been the opponents that are mentioned in the rabbinic texts. Now I want to move to the Qumran calendars a little bit to show you who these may have been. And this is an example from one of the calendrical texts, 4Q321. Now the calendar at Qumran is a different calendar tradition. It represents a 364-day calendar. And I'll get into why that's so special. But what's interesting is that this calendar is found extensively through the Dead Sea Scrolls text. And it's based exclusively on calculation. And we really didn't know much about it until maybe 150 years ago, when it first appeared in the refound text of Jubilees. And really, with the discovery of the Dead Sea Scrolls in 1947 and their ongoing decipherment, really, it adds a whole other dimension to our understanding of not only ancient Judaism, but calendars as well, because many JC scholars point out that this calendar is something that unites uniquely all the Dead Sea Scrolls material, all the stuff that was not known before the discovery of these texts. So the question is who this was. So it may well be that Qumran preserved a more ancient calendrical practice of the Zadokite priests, who after the temple fell under the control of others, particularly probably the Hasmoneans, who usurped the priesthood from the Zadokites. These people removed themselves to Qumran sometime in the 2nd and 1st century BCE, and that's when Qumran was occupied, and that's when a lot of these texts were written or passed on. And getting into Dead Sea Scrolls textual analysis is a whole other subject that I'm trying to skip over here, but we can go into if you want to know more. So this calendar, even though it's 364 days, but it derives from older Mesopotamian lunar calendar traditions, but it integrates the Sabbath. So the way we do this is it takes an extra 30-day month every 3 years. So each lunar cycle is about 354 days. You add 10, it's 364 days, which is conveniently 52 weeks in a year. Now, this tradition is not a singular tradition. It seems to have evolved over time. So just like the rabbinic tradition, it was not just one calendar. It was more of a school or tradition. And I'm going to be just discussing two stages of that. But overall, I want to give you some of the unifying parts of it. This calendar is exactly 52 weeks long. It's based on calculation and not adjusted for astronomical observation. And it begins on the idealized vernal equinox, which is actually why I chose this week to be the time for this presentation, because we're idealized. Today's Wednesday, which is when the calendar begins, because this is the fourth day of the week, the day in which the luminaries are created. So calendar time starts on the fourth day, not the first day of the week. And we're close to the vernal equinox. It was a few days ago, so this is not an echo of the original creation. And it had just 12 non-lunar months, very much like the Gregorian calendar. They were what we call technically schematic months, and I'll get to a short description of what those are. So that was the year. The months, there's 12 in a year, referred to by ordinal number only, like first month, second month, etc. They're grouped into four quarters of the year, each with 91 days, months of 30, 30, and 31 days. And as I said, they're schematic. In some versions of the Dead Sea Scrolls material, there are lunar cycles marked, but they are not referred to as months. And as I said, the months begin on Wednesday. The first month does. And the first day of the months never fall on a Sabbath. This issue of the Sabbath is very important. And some of the older texts included a calculated lunar cycle, but newer ones excluded, and I'll get into why that is the case. So this is a map of a quarterly cycle of the months, starting on Wednesday, and then the other 2 months in the quarter of the year. So this, if we were doing, this might be the first day of the year, maybe. So, the festivals, interestingly, never fall on the Sabbath, which avoids difficulties regarding the appropriate sacrifices. This lack of overlap highlights the independent importance of the Sabbath, in fact. Each annual holiday, now some of the magic of this 364-day calendar is that holidays fall not only on the same date every year as prescribed by the Torah, but on the same day of the week every year. And in many ways, this calendar is much more consistent with the Torah than the rabbinical calendar, because there are never conflicts about which sacrifices you would do when you have the Sabbath and another holiday at the same time. In the calculated Jewish calendar, you have various adjustments for that problem. It's just very consonant. You don't have leap years, things like that. You don't have those kind of problems in this calendar. And this is when all the holidays fall, both the month and the day of the week. Now I want to talk about the first of the two Dead Sea Scrolls calendars I'm going to talk about. The first is what I call the priestly Sabbatarian calendar. Now, each week is named for the priestly course or work shift on duty. In other words, there was a priestly clan that had a duty shift. There were 24 clans, and they had a weekly routine where they would have work shifts in the temple to maintain it every week. And it's interesting that these weeks are like the key cycle of time in the calendar. And it perfectly synchronizes three cycles of the observable cosmos, the stars, the sun, and the moon over a three-year cycle. As I said, you add 30 days and you end up with, that ends up with 364 days a year on average. It adds in the seven-day week defined by the Sabbath, which is a cycle not marked in time. And it makes that of primary importance. The beginning of the month or a holiday is dated by reference to the priestly course on duty in these texts. So for example, one of the texts says, on the third day in the week of the family of Mosiah, and it follows the Pesach, the Passover. So this is really a Sabbatarian calendar. The Sabbath is the linchpin of the synchronous cosmos. And the priests have made themselves very central. In other words, creation takes place in the context of the divinely ordained priestly rotation. And here's a quote from 4Q320, which describes the first day of creation. It's being seen, and it's just an excerpt because, of course, the text is not complete. It's being seen from the east to shine in the middle of the heavens at the foundation of creation from evening till morning on the fourth day of the week of Gamul, the family Gamul, in the first month of the first year. In other words, that first day of creation we talked about, well, the fourth day of creation that we talked about that creates the sun, moon, and stars is on the fourth day of the week. But that fourth day of the week is within the week of this family of Gamul. So it's actually the priestly, the week is actually dominant, and everything else takes place within the framework of the weeks. So there's a notion that there's heavenly harmony and balance. And as I said, and the first month is a spring equinox in the evening with the setting sun, the rising full moon in this text. So you can see this kind of this cosmic harmony that's taking place. It's the equinox with the full moon and the setting sun in the evening. That's when it's created. Because there's, as I said before, with the Bible, there's questions about, like, what shape was the moon when it was created? We don't know. This gives it a particular interpretation. Now, there's a question about where was this calendar used when the Dead Sea Scrolls were first discovered. A lot of the early scholars kind of assumed that this was a very weird calendar just used at Qumran by these sectarians. But a lot of scholars that I happen to agree with think that at some point in time, and there's debates about this or discussions, it was probably used in the Second Temple period, sometime between the 5th century BC and the 1st century CE. And I'll try to go over that sequence towards the end. And it's totally consonant with the Bible, as you can see. Now the problem is, of course, that a calculated 364-day calendar is 1 1/4 days short of a solar year. So, and the texts we have don't describe any method of intercalation to adjust for this. Various techniques have been proposed by scholars that could have extended the functionality for a while. So some people say, on a sabbatical year, for example, every 7 years, add a week, add 7 days. That could have helped it go for a lot longer. So there may have been methods for doing this, but we don't have any evidence of it. And of course, as it started falling behind observed reality, the idealized synchronization of the sun, moon, stars, and Sabbath eventually failed to represent observed reality. And the holidays would begin to drift in their observed seasons, resulting in a dysfunctional calendar. And of course, a dysfunctional calendar would undermine the authority of the people running the calendar, because if it's not working right, you know, you kind of don't know what you're doing. which in the end, a totally different story, is why there was the Gregorian calendar reform of the Julian calendar system, because it was not performing properly. So what were these alternative solutions? There may have been two roads. I think there seems to have been two roads taken, each one sacrificing one dimension of the three-way synchronization of year, lunations, and Sabbath. So the Mishnah that we were talking about earlier, the attitude would be, if the calculations are incorrect regarding the lunation and the seasons, revert to a system based on observation, drawing on the Mesopotamian tradition that was still used in the non-Jewish world, you know, and then various in the Persian Empire and the Seleucid Empire that followed it. And you could keep the moon, but desynchronize the Sabbath and make it, in some sense, subservient to the moon and the year. As we said, you were okay to violate the Sabbath rules if you were reporting on the new moon. That's what I mean by subservient. And the Sabbath ended up running on an independent schedule. The other one that we'll talk about now is the Book of Jubilees, that aimed to maintain the synchrony between the year and the Sabbath, but eliminated the lunation, and even considers that watching the moon is evil, creates evil. And you'll see here in these couple of quotes from the Book of Jubilees, which is from the mid-2nd century BCE, around the time of the Maccabean revolt. Right, now you command the Israelites to keep the years in this number, 364. Oh, and the setting of Jubilees is it's a revelation by an angel to Moses on Mount Sinai. So it's like a rewriting of the Book of Exodus. Now you command the Israelites to keep the years in this number, 364 days. Then the year will be complete, and it will not disturb its time from its days or from its festivals, because everything will happen in harmony with their testimony. They will neither omit a day nor disturb a festival. If they transgress and do not celebrate them in accord with his command, then all of them will disturb their times. The years will be moved from this. They will disturb the times, and the years will be moved, disrupted. They will transgress their prescribed pattern. And all the Israelites will forget and will not find the way of the years. They will forget the first of the month, the season, and the Sabbath. And they will err with respect to the entire prescribed pattern of years. Now, Jubilees, why is it called Jubilees? It's because everything in the book, it has to do with Sabbatarian cycles and Jubilee cycles of time. And it recasts ancient history, the biblical history, in terms of divisions of time. It's actually called the Book of the Divisions of Time. It's probably the most Sabbatarian book in the whole Jewish corpus, Sabbath-oriented. Everything is recast in the order of sevens. Now, it already predicts there will be people who carefully observe the moon with lunar observations because it is corrupt with respect to the season and is early from year to year by 10 days. That's the moon, 364, 54 days. Therefore, years will come about for them when they will disturb the year and make a day of testimony something worthless and a profane day of festival. One of my favorite lines. It's all about getting sacred time right. Now everyone will join together holy days with the profane and the profane day with the holy day, and they will err regarding the months, the Sabbaths, the festivals, and the Jubilee. Now, the attitude here is also, it's kind of shared with the Mishnaic calendars. Everyone wants to get time right. They're trying to get time right by calculating the Sabbath. The Mishnaic calendar wants to get time right by carefully observing the moon. So we have a difference in approach. And in fact, you know, we historians like to look at things. Well, if they're predicting that there was going to be dysfunction, that means they already knew there was dysfunction. And there was already people observing the moon. So, but Jubilee's approach is, if the heavenly lights don't match the theory, it is a problem with the observed reality. So the Jubilee's author's attitude is that it eliminate the wild time of lunation. Of course, the Jubilee's already predicts calendar reform, which is evil. And in fact, I think his attitude is the celestial disorder is due to the sins of those who observe the moon. In other words, that's my reading of the text anyway, that if you just wouldn't be doing this, things would be right. It's they're causing the problem. So it's, I don't know, is this an ancient example of fake news? I don't know. So if we've given you a sequence of two calendars, the rabbinic tradition and two in the Dead Sea Scrolls tradition, I want to kind of wrap up this piece by talking a little bit about what calendar was used in the temple, actually, which was kind of one of my initial questions going into this research. It's really very unclear, but it probably varied over time. I think it was probably not, or not very much, or very often, the observational calendar court that was at Beit Yazik, according to the Mishnah. I mean, why weren't they at the temple? And I have some other examples of conflicts in the text that are reported that make me really question whether this system, the rabbinic system, was really used in the temple ever, or if it was very late in the Second Temple period. Probably at some time, a version of the Qumran calendar, particularly the priestly calendar, was used perhaps as early as Ezra and Nehemiah in the second half of the 5th century BC. In the book of Nehemiah, he reports many reforms to temple practices that are instituted, including the resumption of the Sabbath practice, which either had been forgotten or never known by the people living in Jerusalem. That's all other paper I've given. But this perhaps ended with the Maccabean revolt, because after that is when Jubilees was written and Qumran was settled. And so it may have been, even if it had been used at the temple, it probably stopped being used in the temple at that time. And possibly it was used at times during the Hasmonean period or under Herod. Yeah, I just have a couple more slides. Yeah. And there may be an observational calendar run by the priests under the Hasmonean period, but there's really little evidence of that too. But as an aside note, none of these, as much as conflict as there is, there's no argument about when the Sabbath falls. I guess everyone's been counting seven days consensually for quite some time. So to kind of sum up the historical sequence, I want to recap. Probably in the early Second Temple period, there was a 364-day priestly synchronous calendar where the main time cycle was the Sabbath cycle, and you know that was supported by the priestly courses, the work shifts of the priests. It was succeeded by a 364-day Jubilees calendar where the Sabbath was still central, which may or may not have ever been used in the temple, but may have been followed by the people at Qumran. Perhaps they were the Essenes, it's not totally certain. Then in the Mishnah reports the observational lunisolar calendar, which really emphasized the uncertainty about sighting the first crescent and getting time right. And this evolved into the calculated lunisolar calendar when no observation is necessary, and that the calculated month is the process of declaring the month that the court did evolved into simply calculating. And that's a longer process, which would be another talk. Now, these represent slightly different attitudes towards nature. So in the priestly calendar, there's kind of a divinely revealed cosmos of tame time. There's mathematical harmony, there's sacred geometry. Everything is in wonderful harmonious balance. And despite that not matching the natural world, Jubilees tries to continue or perhaps restore the heavenly harmony by ignoring the moon. In contrast, the observational lunar solar calendar focuses on the uncertainty, what I call the wild time of the moon, because you just don't know when it's going to show up. And that evolves, that eventually gets mathematized and calculated, and that once again tames time. You know, we get control over time. It's not uncertain. I mean, you hear this argument between these two versions of the rabbinic calendar, between the observational and the calculated. I hear echoes of that when Ramadan comes around and Muslims are talking about observing the new moon and when does Ramadan begin and can we see it and not see it, is it observed or not, and that sort of thing. Those are echoes of the same issue that came about in ancient times in the Jewish calendar. To conclude, we can see in these texts the tactics engaged in by elite groups aiming to gain authority, legitimacy, and power. They can't really control time, but they can construct the human experience of time. and ongoing shifts in attitudes to natural versus artificial time between the moon and the Sabbath. And you can see how they're differently negotiated here. And I think that the calculated Hebrew calendar in use today preserves echoes of these ancient controversies in the unruly lack of fit between the rhythms of the Sabbath and the lunation. So, thank you very much. I hope it didn't take too much time.